to be in Bonn in this interesting new building and a nice garden and so on. It should be an interesting event this week. I have heard that your background is rather mixed, which means that I probably will assume something that some of you know and some don't. Of course, all of you are invited to ask questions if you don't know something I talk about. So my topic will be symmetries in non-commutative geometry. And starting with a rather broad outline first, so you probably all know that in non-commutative geometry, we generalize the notion of space. So instead of the ordinary topological spaces or manifolds, people have been studying for a long time. We look at non-commutative spaces, and I think I will always model them by Z-star algebras. Of course, you might also look at different types of algebras, like algebras of smooth functions on these spaces, but for my talks, it will only be Z-star algebras, although probably you can do similar things in other categories, and there are even good reasons for doing that. Now, if you have generalized your notion of space, does this lead to a new notion of symmetry? If you work with ordinary spaces, how would you describe their symmetries? I suppose you might use something like a group, maybe a groupoid if you have heard what they are. So here in this world, the classical symmetries you might have in mind are probably groups and groupoids, and they certainly act on spaces, and this is how symmetries appear. Just a question to see what people know. Who among you has already worked with groupoids or knows a bit more than the definition of a groupoid, let's say? Who has never heard about groupoids? No one. That's good for Eric. For me as well. So everyone already knows what a groupoid is. Now, so these would be classical symmetries then. What could you put here? So what corresponds to groups and groupoids acting on spaces in the world of Z-star algebras? Something you might have heard about. Well, any suggestions from you? What would you put there? If you were asked to fill in this table, what would be the right version of, well, non-commutative groups? Yeah? Hopf algebras or called quantum groups, maybe, yes. That is something you could put here. I mention this because my talk won't be about them. I will do something else. But of course, I should mention that there is some other tested approach. Suppose in the world of Z-star algebras, you might use Z-star algebraic types of Hopf algebras, which are quite technical. And although they have been around already for 30 years or so, examples are quite hard to find, especially if you want to have not compact, but locally compact quantum groups and do it Z-star algebraically. This is a very technical and difficult subject. So for applications, it doesn't seem so great. I will actually use a rather different point of view, where groups and groupoids are replaced by what I might call two groups and two groupoids. And to give you a very brief idea what this is about, groupoids are also a source of non-commutative spaces. So probably you have met groupoids if you work on Z-star algebras, because many interesting Z-star algebras are groupoid Z-star algebras. So when you generalize from spaces to non-commutative spaces, well, group Z-star algebras and groupoids are becoming now spaces and no longer symmetries. symmetries. And the way this happens now is that there is another layer of structure which you can add. So if you have a groupoid, let's say, then you have objects and arrows. And the structure describes how they interact and what properties they have. In a two-groupoid, you have objects, arrows, and two arrows between arrows. And then you describe what properties and structures you would have in this context. The definitions get rather technical at some point. So I think I won't yet mention them very early. I will first talk about C-star algebras as a bicategory. Meaning, if you talk about C-star algebras, what should be arrows and two arrows? And then this will just come in quite naturally. So this is also something you might ask if you think about symmetries of some structure. The first thing you might answer is nowadays, if you want to talk about symmetries, how do you put these objects into a category? Because you might have different ideas what type of arrows you put between your objects, and depending what arrows you choose, you have a different category of mathematical objects, and they could have different symmetries. And it can easily happen that the same type of object has quite different symmetries depending on how you look at it. If you think about spaces, for instance, then maybe you think that you are a homotopy theorist, so you only care about homotopy classes of maps. And then you might get a different notion of what the symmetry of an object is than if you are taking all maps as different. Of course, if you then take homotopy classes of maps as your symmetry groups, you will get some problems, which we also meet here on a slightly more tractable level. So doing this correctly is not easy. I should mention that all this stuff about two groups and so on, and even higher things, I think it probably comes from algebraic topology, where people were faced with the problem of taking homotopy classes correctly. Because taking homotopy classes is a kind of identifying things which are not really equal. Of course, sometimes they behave equal, but working out exactly when and why, you have to be careful, and a good way to do the bookkeeping is higher category theory. But we are doing C-star algebras, and in that context, I won't take homotopy as my equivalence relation on arrows, I will do something else. So the first question would be, what are the right arrows between C-star algebras? And there are even several different classical answers to the question. So if you have by the way, can you all hear me fine? That's good. I think seeing is a bit more difficult in this crowded room. Well, especially in the last rows, but I can't do anything about that. So if you have two C-star algebras, then what could you take as arrows between A and B? Now, there are some obvious answers. And since I'm talking about C-star, I might put them in this column here, so that I have the classical analog over there. So let's try to make this column a bit like this. So of course, there's an obvious answer, namely star homomorphisms between these C-star algebras. Who knows what corresponds to this on the side of locally compact spaces, let's say, because you know probably that commutative C-star algebras are, by Gelfand's theorem, the same as, let's say, locally compact spaces by taking the spectra. But which maps of spaces correspond to star homomorphisms between C0x and C0y? Any suggestions? So Massoud says proper continuous maps. They put them in a different row because they don't correspond to them. Um, Yes. Any other suggestions? Aha, that's another interesting row. Any other suggestion? Yes, that's a good one. I think I probably want also to map base point to base point. I would call them pointed maps between one-point compactifications. Well, I think I have to continue somewhere here and I put it in where there's room. Yeah, this table is getting a bit too small, I suppose. So here you have to suppose to put in pointed maps between the one-point compactifications of the spaces, because that's what's really happening with these star homomorphisms. So if you have compact spaces, then indeed star homomorphisms are unital, are the same thing as continuous maps. And if you have a map from A to B, it extends to a map between the unitalizations, where you just add a unit, so you take what's called A plus, maybe. And so this would be a map from A plus to B plus would then correspond to a map between the spectrum of B plus to the spectrum of A plus. And since you did something trivial on the unit element, they will map the base point to the base point, which means that they are pointed maps, so, or base point preserved, but that's even longer. So this is what corresponds to star homomorphisms from A to B, really. These are maps between one-point compactifications. So the statement that these star algebras are like locally compact spaces actually is not quite the best way of putting it. It's better to say that they are generalized pointed compact spaces, because if you take this category here, then you really are implicitly adding a unit element to your C-star algebra and looking at maps that act on unital C-star algebras and are compatible with this augmentation character, so that they are like pointed maps between pointed non-commutative compact spaces. I might also write this down. So okay, now I have two more rows in my table. These are three reasonable categories of locally compact spaces. I suppose the first row wouldn't be in the table if it wasn't that it's the most natural thing on the level of C-star algebras. Continuous maps is something you often want to use. And if you want to have analog of continuous maps for C-star algebras, then what you will get is what, well, the Warsaw School, like Bronowicz, would call a morphism of C-star algebras. And I think I should briefly introduce them. So a morphism this will be a non-degenerate star homomorphism from A to the multiplier algebra of B. Non-degenerate means that phi of A times B is equal to B. You might wonder why these things really form a category, because you go from A to M of B. So how do you compose such things? It turns out that these are the same. So you can extend such map to the multiplier algebra. So you will get certain star homomorphisms from M of A to M of B. And the ones you get are the strictly continuous and unital ones. strictly continuous refers to a certain topology on the multiplier algebra, which is called strict topology, and has something to do with how multipliers are defined as acting on A. If you want, I can define it, but otherwise you can just look it up. So it's the property that characterizes in this context which homomorphism from M of A to M of B are extensions of something on A in this kind of canonical way. For instance, if you take the quotient from M of A to M of A mod A, which is also some interesting C-st algebra, this would probably not be strictly continuous if you start with that, because it vanishes on A. And if a map of this type vanishes on A, well, this can't happen at all, of course, but so such things cannot come from a non-degenerate map like this. Once you're at this stage, of course, you can just compose these maps quite easily. So these morphisms are used in the theory of C-st algebraic quantum groups because at least the locally compact quantum groups are supposed to be like locally compact groups. And if you take the multiplication map of a locally compact group, that is certainly a continuous map, but it's never proper. So you cannot hope to be one of these other categories here. So you must work with these quite general morphisms. Okay, and now the proper continuous maps, they correspond to they're like the intersection of these other two classes. You could say they are those star homomorphisms from A to B which are non-degenerate in the same sense as this. Or you could say they are those morphisms where the image is contained in B, not just in M of B. So you might also talk about proper morphisms. Those are morphisms which actually have a range in B, not in M of B. Okay, so this was these are the three natural categories of C-st algebras that you can look at. And it already gets pretty confusing at this point because you have three different choices. Fortunately, they all have the same automorphisms or even isomorphisms. Once you have a category, you can ask, what are the isomorphisms in that category? And this proposition tells you, well, in the end, it tells you that all these three categories have the same isomorphisms. They are just the usual star isomorphisms of C-st algebras. How does the composition work? The composition works by extending F and G to multiplier algebras, as I, there's no pointer here, right? So I have to move it down again. So if you have one of these maps A to M of B, then there's a unique, strictly continuous extension to map M of A to M of B. And that's how this composition is defined. So really, you should maybe put a little bar on this F here and also on this G to mark that this here is really an extension of the map. But if you work with these morphisms, you soon don't do the bars anymore, but just think of these as the same thing. So that's how you compose them. And so the first line here describes what an isomorphism in this category is. It's two maps so that when you compose them, you get identity morphisms. I've also used that the identity morphism is really what you think it should be, namely the identity map from A to B. That's also the identity in this category of morphisms. And so the statement is that if you have this situation, then these two things are really inverse to each other. I'm not sure I should do the proof of this because I should remember a trick. So the proof is two lines, if you know the right trick. And of course, I've written it in some notes for a previous course I gave on a similar topic in Buenos Aires, and I should remember it. Well, let's see whether, I think I don't do the blackboard today because I might get confused, and it's better to read this short argument or think about it yourself. It's not difficult if you know the right trick. Of course, you can spend a lot of time to find it. In some sense, this tells us that you don't invent new symmetries of C-star algebras this way, because you always get back to the old star isomorphisms and nothing new. Now, if you have seen constructions of C-star algebras from groupoids, then you might have met another type of, well, equivalence of C-star algebras, which is not isomorphism, it's weaker. So who knows some notion of equivalence of C-star algebras that's weaker than isomorphism? Yes, indeed. So Morita equivalence is an important equivalence relation because in many situations, if you try to construct a C-star algebra that describes a certain non-commutative space, you might do some artificial choices to do it. It's a bit like imposing coordinates on a space. And then if you are lucky, the choice doesn't matter too much. But you normally don't expect that the resulting C-star algebras are independent of choices completely, but only up to Morita equivalence. So we could also call it Morita-Riefel equivalence because it was Riefel who introduced this notion correctly in the C-star algebraic framework. There are actually two different ways of defining it, but maybe let's first give an example of this. If you know what groupoids are, maybe you also have heard about groupoid C-star algebras. And if your groupoid is not what's called étale, then to construct a C-star algebra, you have to choose what's called a Haar system for the groupoid. If you don't know what this really is, it's just a remark that you don't have to understand much, but a Haar system is a choice. There could be many different Haar systems on the same groupoid, and the groupoid C-star algebra depends on that choice. There's a theorem which says that if you choose different Haar systems, then the resulting groupoid C-star algebras are always Morita-Riefel equivalent, although isomorphism is less clear. They might be isomorphic, they might not be. That depends a bit on, how well you understand your groupoid. At least proving isomorphism is not easy. It's certainly not a canonical isomorphism in any sense, but there's a rather canonical Morita-Riefel equivalence between groupoid C-star algebras for different Haar systems. And if you like étale groupoids and maybe you like foliations, if you take a foliation holonomic groupoid, then to construct C-star algebra, you can do it directly, but you might also pick a transversal, which means a sufficiently large subset that meets every leaf. And if you do it correctly, then you will replace your groupoid by some étale groupoid this way, by restricting it to a transversal. This also depends on the chosen transversal, but different transversals will give you Morita equivalent groupoids. even also then groupoid C-star algebras, because they're all equivalent to the original groupoid and therefore to that groupoid C-star algebra. So I'll just mention these examples. Maybe I should say complete transversals. So the idea of a complete transversal is you have a sufficiently large subset of the object space so that the restriction of the groupoid to that subset is equivalent to the original groupoid in a suitable sense. Meaning, let's say that the inclusion of this subgroupoid is, well, it's always fully faithful, but it should also be what's called essentially surjective. If you want to know more about it, you can talk to me after the lecture. I think I won't mention this here. So these are just examples. Another question, who among you likes graph C-star algebras? Anyone likes graph C-star algebras? I know Rasmus, of course, not so many. Also in that context, you sometimes could do some modifications of graphs, which are useful to make the computations easier. For instance, you might want to replace an arbitrary graph by one which has no sinks or something like this. And you can do this, but I think you also only get the same C-star algebra up to real equivalence that way. So there are various contexts where it's nice to have these real equivalences as really being equivalences. Who has never used real equivalence before? For C-star algebras. Anyone doesn't know what this is about? No hands. So who has been working with real equivalence before? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So many people are undecided as always. So let me briefly talk about what this notion means, and then we can. So this is a rather restrictive kind of category. It won't be quite a category. It's like talking about isomorphisms only. So I didn't put in here the fourth possible arrows, which are star isomorphisms. They would correspond to homeomorphisms on this side, of course. This would be a rather restrictive category because you can only talk about isomorphisms, but not about, well, different things being at all related. It's a bit boring, maybe. And similarly, here we have only the isomorphisms. At some point, you then want to relax the conditions and make some non-isomorphisms also arrows in your categories. But let's first talk about the isomorphism, then relax the conditions. So so I will call these things Morita-Riefel equivalence. This maybe equivalence bimodules. Many authors would call them imprimitivity bimodules. This name goes back to work of Mackey in representation theory. I think it's more historical notation than really that it has much to do with being imprimitive. Not even I haven't studied the history of this term. So these are just different names for the same thing, which aren't really well explained. Of course, Morita and Riefel are people who well, did some interesting work in this connection. So I have to now come to the definition of this thing. Who among you knows Hilbert modules? That should be almost everyone. OK. So it is the Hilbert B module. Give it a name. I'm going to call it E. This definition is one of several equivalent ways of defining it. It's not so symmetric. So I say it is the Hilbert B module. E, together with an isomorphism from A onto the compact operators on this Hilbert B module E. Who doesn't know what compact operator here means? No hands. That's very good. You're well prepared. Anyway, let's briefly recall why this definition is symmetric. So this definition looks to be unsymmetric because you have a Hilbert B module. This means that E carries a left A action and a right B action. And these actions have to commute because this left action is, well, in particular by B model homomorphisms, even by compact operators. Also, a Hilbert module means that you have an inner product with values in B. But there's more now because I want to define now an A value in a product. How can I do this? So Xi and eta are two vectors in my Hilbert module. I could. I have put these two brackets here to make it it's something else than the one with values in B. You could put the on the left. There are different ways. So this may be in a product on the left, not on the right, because it's for the left A module structure. And some people like to put a subscript on the left. I don't like left subscripts so much, although I could have used them in this context. It's a matter of notation. What can I do? First of all, given these two operators, Xi and eta, I can construct a rank one operator out of that, which is how we define the compact operators. My preferred notation for this is the physicist one with these ket and bra operators. So this is a rank one operator, and it's defined, we're putting another variable here, by multiplying with inner products. So the definition of this rank one operator is, in this notation, just straightforward to read. Many people write this something like theta, xi, eta, or something. This is the same thing. This is just maybe a more intuitive notation for the same thing. Now, this thing here is a generator for these compact operators. And since I'm given this isomorphism phi, I can use phi inverse and put this into A. And so in this way, I can define an A linear product as well, given this data. And indeed, if you check the definition that you have here, you find out that this is now also a left Hilbert A module. So this inner product here has the expected properties of a Hilbert module structure on the left. And also by design, if you now use the left A module structure with this inner product on a third vector, then what you get is just xi times the other inner product. So this is exactly how the compatibility condition looks like for other definitions of imprimitivity bimodules. So another definition would say that you have an A, B bimodule with two inner products, as well as an A and B, with some properties like those of a Hilbert module on both sides, together with this compatibility condition. And if you have this condition, you can actually go backwards, and you can see that the inner product on as well as an A has to be of this form for an isomorphism from A to the compact operators. So it's really the same notion. Okay, so that is the definition of a Morita-Riefel equivalence. Full means that the inner products, when you take the ideal they generate, it is the whole C-star algebra. This is assumed for imprimitivity bimodules. We don't assume full. We have what's called a Hilbert bimodule. And Hilbert bimodules are a bit different. In that case, for instance, you could have that the image of phi is maybe larger than the compact operator, something like that. Some kind of cleaning equipment. Let's see, do I want to do it wet or not? I think I want to do it wet. now I'm defining an important notion for these talks, namely a C-star correspondence. These are supposed to be the arrows I'm going to use. And it looks like my definition of a Morita equivalence, except that I now allow the range of this to be B of E instead of only K of E. And I should maybe explain what non-degenerate means. In this context, there are two different ways you could think about being non-degenerate, which fortunately are the same. I won't prove this, but it's not hard to see that it's non-degenerate in the sense that phi of A times E is E, or at least dense in E. So such a statement probably means that the linear span of these things is dense. But you could also use some results like the Cohen-Hewitt factorization theorem to see that this is the same as a stronger version of the same statement. So in this case, it actually doesn't matter how you interpret the statement. They are all equivalent, but by theorems, not by just obvious results. And similarly here, and if you look at this definition, another remark maybe, B of E here stands for the C-star algebra of adjointable operators on this Hilbert module. And it's known that this is, well, probably only isomorphic, not equal to the multiplier algebra of K of E in a very canonical way. And so what we have here is that phi is a morphism from A to K of E. If you use this definition of being non-degenerate, then you see exactly a morphism from A to K of E. I forgot an important assumption in my definition of an equivalence, namely this Hilbert model E should be full on the right, otherwise it doesn't work, of course. I forgot to write this down. So there is an adjective missing here. Namely full. I dropped it because I wanted to omit it later anyway, so for the correspondences you don't assume it's full. Maybe I should explain what full means for good measure so that it's not interpretable. So for an equivalence, you want that this Hilbert module E is large enough so that its inner products generate all of B. For instance, if you have an ideal in B and you have an equivalence from A to this ideal, that shouldn't be an equivalence to B as well. And with my definition, without the word full in there, it would be, so there must be something wrong with it. And full means, so E. This was B on the right, not A. Okay, so I've explained there what it means for a Hilbert module to be full. And you need this Hilbert module to be full in order to get an equivalence. But just for a C-star correspondence, you don't care. For instance, you could take E to be zero. That would be a legitimate C-star correspondence, a pretty boring one, of course. It corresponds to the zero homomorphism between C-star algebras. So, let's look at... I was just doing this example now. So if you're given a star homomorphism, how do you turn this into a C-star correspondence? So this is supposed to give me some kind of category of C-star algebras that combines morphisms and Mourid equivalences. So if E is a full Hilbert module, then this K of E here is Morita-Wiefel equivalent to B, because if you look at this phi there, if you take A to be K of E, of course it works. And if E is full, then also this extra assumption I just added is satisfied. So you do get an equivalence from K of E to B. So if you take only those C star correspondences where E is full, then what you will see is that you have a morphism from A to a C star algebra, which is Morita equivalent to B. So you have combined morphisms and Morita-Wiefel equivalences, which is what you want to do. Adding the non-full ones here is doesn't do much in the end. But it's not convenient to assume this to be full all the time. Sometimes you want to allow non-full situations. So examples would be if you have a star homomorphism already, how do you turn this into a C-star correspondence? So I first take a morphism, meaning it's non-degenerate. Then I do also an example where it's degenerate and see what happens there. So then you take E and if you take the adjointable operators on this B, it is just a multiplier algebra of B. This is because of this, well, actually a theorem which I won't prove, and because if you look at B as the Hilbert model over itself, then the compact operators are just B. So here you will just get a map to multipliers of B, and we are given phi here. Or you might just say you take the left multiplication to be given by phi. Now let's take just a star homomorphism, possibly degenerate. What can you do then? Well, in that case, you take E to be this subspace. This is actually a closed right ideal. So this is a Hilbert B module. And if you then look at E and the left action with phi, this does become non-degenerate by construction of this E. So so also, star homomorphisms, even degenerate ones, give you C-star correspondences. If you have the intersection of both cases, so you have a proper morphism, meaning that phi goes from A to B, or if you say that phi here is non-degenerate, then this E here is just the same as B. So you will get the same construction in both cases if you have a proper morphism. So you have two compact spaces, and if you want to describe their correspondences, it gets pretty complicated if you want to describe them completely. For instance, you could take a vector bundle over your second space. A vector bundle, you take its sections. This will be a Hilbert module, even a very special one. And then you could act on the left by, let's say just you have a map from between the spaces and you act by pointwise multiplication. But you could do more complicated things. You could also do some kind of branched covers. If you think about it, so you could, in each fiber, you could, well, in each fiber you have an n by n matrix algebra. So the action on that fiber would be given by some n point evaluations on your space. And these points where you evaluate move around in your origin on your domain space. But there could be the same on different places, so there could be some branchings in this thing. It gets somewhat complicated. I don't think that there is a good classification of these things. Mm-hmm. Yes, here also need to put in these Hilbert, the Hilbert module structures. And I think already the vector bundle is something you could also at an algebraic geometry. You could put in some kind of multiplicities. So the notion of correspondence in algebraic geometry would say you have a space that maps to both, let's say. But if you think about these Baum-Douglas theory, which you know probably, then you put on a vector bundle on this space in the middle, which is something you should definitely do also here if you want to get closer to these C-star correspondences. But even then, it might still be not quite the same. So classifying all correspondences from A to B might not be an accomplishable task. It might be pretty complicated to describe all of them. In practice, you just don't ask this question unless you can answer it reasonably. So probably you have some special correspondences you care about and you work with them, and you never try to classify all of them that exist because there are too many and their structure is too complicated. They are easy, they're just line bundles. So if you have a root equivalence, it means that K of E has to be also commutative. And this means that if you have now a continuous field of Hilbert spaces, maybe I should at least give this remark. So if B is C0x, then any I won't define continuous fields of Hilbert spaces for you. It's a somewhat technical notion. It certainly means you have a Hilbert space for every point in X. And then it also means you have a good notion of what continuous sections of this field are. It could be given by a certain topology on the total space if you like, or you just write down the continuous section and that's actually enough to determine everything. And if you are given any Hilbert B module, then you can find such a continuous field so that you get exactly its C0 sections, and vice versa, so these are the same notion. Now, to have a correspondence, you also have a left action, meaning you should look now at the compact operators here. The compact operators will be the C0 sections of the field of compact operators on these fibers here, which also inherit a continuity structure. The adjoint operators are, they are only continuous in a weaker sense, namely the strict sense, in a suitable topology, which is not the norm topology. And they are then sections of the field of bounded operators on these Hilbert spaces. Now, if you want to have a more reach equivalence between two commutative C-star algebras, then the compact operators have to be commutative. And this means that the fibers have to be commutative. And this means that all of these HX have to be one-dimensional. And then you have a line bundle. Also, in this one-dimensional case, the continuity structure really is the same as that you would have for an ordinary line bundle. So you get local trivality for free. And if you have a line bundle, then also the left action is just given by a homeomorphism between these underlying spaces. So if two spaces are equivalent, they actually are homeomorphic. But an interesting subtlety is that the equivalence could be a bit more than just a homeomorphism. It could be a homeomorphism plus a line bundle. And the line bundle is part of the equivalence. Why is that interesting? I don't have 5 minutes, but for instance, you might look at automorphism of the space to construct cross-product C-star algebras. So if you have just a space X and some homeomorphism, you can, of course, construct now an interesting C-star algebra from that. But you might also twist that by putting on a line bundle, and you can still do a cross-product from that situation. So if you are given a homeomorphism of a space X plus a line bundle, you can also construct a kind of cross-product algebra from that data. For instance, non-commutative Heisenberg manifolds are of this type, which Olivier Gabriel, the audience, knows quite well. And there are some more examples you could construct in this way. And in this context, it's important that you construct C-star algebras from not just an isomorphism, but from a Morita-Riefel equivalence, which you're using to construct this C-star algebra. And then if you take different line bundles on the same space, they would give you different Hilbert modules and therefore different automorphisms from them. Yes. But here there are actually more isomorphisms than just homeomorphisms because already what's called the Picard group, I think, is already built into this category here because line bundles are part of the isomorphisms already. So much time, so maybe I should decide now. I think I'll now introduce the two arrows right away and talk about composition later because that's more complicated. So well, if you try to classify all correspondences between two C-style algebras, then of course the first thing is that you should classify only up to isomorphism at best, because otherwise you don't even have a set of things what you have on your class. And isomorphism is the most obvious thing you can imagine, is something preserving all structure, meaning bimodal structure of A and B, and write B with inner product. So you have a unitary operator only here as your isomorphisms. Okay, and now there is maybe one example I should give you just before the end to show that these isomorphisms are doing something interesting, namely, I think I take two morphisms. So what would happen if you take two morphisms with C-star algebras, turn them into C-star correspondences by this recipe up there? And what is an isomorphism of such correspondences? Well, you should have a unitary from B to itself, which is the same as the unitary multiplier of B. And then it should also be compatible with the left action, which means that you have this condition here. Or you might also say that F2 is the composite of conjugation by U, which I call at U, and F1. So you have somehow identified inner automorphism as something trivial. So if you work with C-star correspondences, then you see that inner automorphisms are in some sense more trivial than generic automorphisms. This is a good thing because in many circumstances, indeed, they act trivially in some sense, but there are also other circumstances where you can't just consider them as being trivial, so you must be a bit more careful here, and that's why it's not a good idea to just take isomorphism classes of correspondences and stick with that. So if you look into older papers, you might find this category mentioned that you get by taking isomorphism classes of C-star correspondences and used for some purposes, and some things you can do with that. But if you talk about, let's say, group actions by correspondences or something like that, it wouldn't work if you take isomorphism classes at this early stage. But this is something for the next lecture. I should stop now. I'm happy with questions, if there are any. Where? Here? Yes, that's an E1. Yeah?
You have a sort of generalized morphism from the group of different families.
A Hilsum Scandalis one doesn't. But there's another notion of generalized morphism which one of my doctoral students is actually, well, he's writing a thesis and he's defending this week, which does work. So you have to have somewhat different technical conditions on these bi-bundles. You need a family of measures on the bi-bundle as well. You need a family of measures because in the most simple-minded case, if you have just one point groupoids, so point and point, you're going to construct a Hilbert space out of a space, and for this you need a measure on the space. And if you find the right definitions, then you can construct a category of groupoids so that taking groupoid C-star algebras is a functor to the C-star correspondence by category even. But it's not Hilsum Scandalis morphisms. And one reason you might see this, if you look at non-commutative tori, they are, well, if you look at the groupoids underlying them, then they are like two groups, so there is some addition structure on them. So the quotient circle mod integers is a group. And the group structure can be given by Hilsum-Scandalis morphisms. But there is no trace of that at the C-style algebraic level, because these Hilsum-Scandalis morphisms do not induce anything for C-style algebras. Yeah? Not yet. If it is proper, meaning that phi of A is contained in compacts, then you get a KK correspondence. But this is like if you have morphisms in the sense of maps from A to M of B, even those would not give a KK class. And even if you think about spaces, K-theory is only functorial for proper maps, or more precisely, it is really an invariant for pointed compact spaces the way we treat it, and it's invariant for maps between these one-point compactifications. But it's not a functor for arbitrary continuous maps. And this is supposed to be continuous maps, even generalized, building in equivalences. So you don't expect a KK class unless you put extra assumptions like properness. And then it's obvious because you take F to be zero. One more question in the back, even two. Maybe Sniggy first. Yes, they are the two arrows in my by category. Well, bi-category theory gets much easier if you use things like simplicial sets in this context. Of course, if you just do bi-categories, then there is no strict reason why you shouldn't allow more general things here. If you like, you could also take arbitrary intertwiners here, maybe even, well, so then the question is, do you take isometries, not necessarily adjointable things, or do you take adjointable operators? There are different choices. I think the interesting choice would be to take non-adjointable isometries there, but then I'm not sure you can do much with that. So there are variations possible here, but so far I saw no good applications for them. And there was another question in the back. You mean for C-star correspondences? You can't do it at all. So what you can do is, if you have something degenerate, so if phi of A times E is not E, then you just take this to be your E prime, and then you restrict phi of A to this, and this will be now a correspondence in the correct sense. And the thing is that at some point you want unit arrows in your bi-category. So you need something like this, because the unit element has to be something like A as a bimodal over itself. And this property here says that this thing is non-general on the left. And if you do not assume that, you don't have units in your category, which is a bit unfortunate. So you should assume non-degeneracy all the time.